gaps in social protection could compromise recovery plans, says the International Labor Organization. With us now for more is Nunu Kunya, the Senior Specialist in Social Protection at the ILO in Bangkok. Good to see you, Nunu. Welcome to the program.
Thank you. Good morning. And thank you for the invitation.
Sure. You know, it's a compelling argument the ILO brief presents when it says, while the virus does not discriminate between rich and poor, its effects are highly uneven. To what extent has that made access to quality health care as a matter of life and death?
Yes, I think one of the elements that this crisis made very clear was that societies are only protected as much as the most vulnerable are protected. I think we saw this with countries when they didn't have the capacity to cover and to protect everyone in an equal matter, that this end up affecting everyone and the capacity of countries to deal with the crisis. It also showed clearly the gaps it make, but I would say make those that are usually invisible more visible to everyone, like informal sector workers who have limited access many times to social protection, but also that had to face a choice many times between working and taking a risk or losing their income, and showed clearly that social protection needs to be one of the pillars of the societies, not only during a crisis, but especially a crisis like this made it even more clear. In the case of health, we know also that, for instance, having groups that are not able to access else or don't have, for instance, sickness benefits that allows them to stay at home when sick, this becomes also an additional risk for the societies. And therefore, this makes our call that has been there for years, our call for universal social protection, even more important. And we feel also maybe more relevant in the current discussion at global, regional, and even country level.
Yeah, the invisible made more visible because of the pandemic. Just looking back at history, the Ebola epidemic taught us that a laser focus on one health issue worsens mortality from other conditions or diseases that kill people every day, such as malaria or tuberculosis. So how do you advise policymakers to avoid falling into such a singular focus just in COVID-19?
I think if you read the ILO position, if you read what we've been advising, is to look at the system, the health system as a whole, and not focus. Of course, you are under a very specific situation. You need to focus on COVID-19, and I think that's what countries have been doing. At the same time, it's clear that you need to have a comprehensive and holistic attention to health. I mean, a strategy that ensures that you are not, because of focusing too much on the COVID, you are not leaving behind other diseases and other conditions. And it's not only health, it's also when you look at income security. If our focus is only, if we limit our focus on health, we might also be losing on the people having access to income, and this might lead indirectly also for people to take even less attention to health. And that's been our point. Especially, we also launched a brief 2 weeks ago on the informal economy, and there it was very clear the need to put in place measures to protect income if we want to ensure that people can actually take care of their health too.
Yeah, to your point on the gaps in the sickness benefit coverage, people with no sick benefits are forced to go to work even as they are sick, increasing the risk of infecting others. So what short-term measures does the ILO propose to close that gap between coverage and adequacy?
Yeah, just maybe before you, if you allow me, I think it's also important because many times we see the protection and we think about the workers, but we also need to see from a business perspective. If someone has someone coming sick to work and there's a risk of infecting other workers, and this might be actually killing the opportunity for the business, for the company to keep running. And therefore, sickness benefits, as we always have been expressing, is not only during this crisis, but it's important for workers, but also important for business. And I think, and in terms of extending, of course, our main, and this for the ILO is not something new. We have been talking about the need to extend coverage to the informal sector, to find innovations and alternatives, maybe to reduce somehow the costs of what we call formalization. And we need especially in a moment that we already see it now, we start to see the first numbers coming, the projections from IMF. We start seeing some countries in the region bringing the first numbers on GDP GDP in terms of the first quarter, but also estimations for the rest of the year. And an important measure, a message now especially, it's that we need to move. We have been putting in place and watching measures that are more like emergency measures to deal with the crisis, but we know the crisis will be long. We don't know how it will move, what will be the progress, but we know that economically the impacts will not stay within these months, will be longer, and we need to start thinking about social protection as part of a longer response to deal with a long crisis. And this is, in my view, something that countries now, it's part of our recommendations, is to start thinking midterm and even long term, and to start thinking how to ensure that the expansion we did now in terms of social protection can become sustained and sustainable.
That makes sense. A healthy worker is good business. Well, thank you, Nuno. You keep well. I look forward to the country assessment on social protection once out. Nuno Cunha,
thank you very
ILO
much.
In Bangkok.